Welcome to the Kimes Ranch booth here at the Stetson Country Christmas. We're here with Quinn Kessler, who is one of our KRJ family members, and this is his first NFR. Quinn, how does it feel?
Feels pretty good. I'm glad to be here. It's been a dream of mine since I was really young, so it's definitely a dream come true. I'm glad to have this support with everyone.
Well, we are glad to have you here. Tonight is the first round of the NFR, but you've been here all week, haven't you?
Pretty much, yeah. I got here Monday night, and Tuesday we roped the steers, and yesterday we checked in and got all that handled, so we're ready.
So how do the steers look this year?
They're pretty beefy. They're pretty big, got big horns, pretty strong. They were pretty fresh. I think we won't see, I mean, obviously the times will be fast, but I think if you're four on them the first few nights, it'll be doing pretty good.
We're also joined with Farron Lucero from AQHA. Thanks for coming to us, Farron.
Oh, thanks for having me, Lainey. Glad to be here.
We're glad to have you here. So we're going to talk to Farron a little bit about the AQHA PRCA Horses of the Year. Tell us a little bit about that. We have kind of a rookie class coming in.
Yeah, you know, I was able to attend last night the banquet that they had for those horses and got to meet some of those owners, those guys that rode them. And you know, it's neat just to hear the story about the horses. There's just so much importance into it. I mean, you're a team, you're competing at such a high level that you know, a horse is going to help make the difference. You know, you got Clayton Haas with Landry's Cadillac. You're going to see that horse. That horse got three of those guys, Tyler Ty and Clayton, top five in steer wrestling. And he was horse of the year in 2014 and then again this year. One of those guys will be riding another one on horse of the year last year. I was sitting next to Chris Glover, his horse Champ. He's a 17-year-old horse. Boy, you talk to Chris about this horse and his eyes would just light up. He said, man, I'd never have had a horse like this. You just sit on him and you just go. Jake Long was there. He's got a horse. Colonel, I believe, is what he calls him. Colonel Freckles. He's the grandson of Colonel Freckles, I believe, or that may be Timbers. But anyway, Jake's real proud of this horse. He's excited, just real low-key type of horse. Colton Schmidt's riding Badger, and you know, he's kind of a horse that says he's a hard horse to get along with, but this horse will get his job done, something special. So it's going to be exciting to see that. And then Timbers got a real nice one underneath him in the tie-down. He's coming in second. And just to hear the stories about those horses and what those horses have done and what they mean to them. You know, their peers, guys like Quinn here, the horsemen, cowboys, they know, you know, they get to vote on them and they say, you know, to have these kind of guys vote on these horses is pretty special. It makes us feel, hey, we got to support them.
Going back to the Colonel Freckles, we've seen so many horses go from the cutting or the pen over into the done really well. Why do you think that it's such an important crossover?
Well, you know, in those, it's just been something that's been through, and it's just like the other horse that there was two ties for the tie down. As a Leo bred horse, it was a big time cutter. This horse, I mean, also makes great cow horses, and you see him in tripping. Shining Spark, great rain horse, I believe that's Timbers on Timbers' side. So we got a horse that got the stop and got everything, all the tools. And it's neat to see that crossover. I don't know if a lot of people think about that. See what those horses can do, and that, you know, that's something that really needs to be brought to life. Hey, open your mind to some of these things, see what these guys are doing, and see how it can help and benefit you.
Well, I think it's so interesting how different the horse world, the horse show world is to the rodeo world. You don't see a lot of crossover with the competitors, but you see tons of crossover in the horses, even between the cutting and the reining and the tail horse. And now you have it going into the tie-down horses, like to the rodeo horses. And it's just incredible.
You'll see Clay Logan performance horses there around Stephenville. And he'll take a lot of those cutters, and they'll be the most awesome hill horses you've ever seen in your life. I mean, he'll just turn them around and just make you drool over them. They're amazing. He does a great job.
Now, horses are so important when you get into a small building like this, especially with the top 15, the top 14 breathing down your neck. Quinn, what kind of horses are you riding this year?
I'm riding my old horse I call Hickory. I've had him since I was, I think, 10. He actually is cut and bred. He'd had a couple rides when we got him, but he was so easy. I mean, when he was four, I was pretty much on him everywhere, even being as young as I was, because he was so good-minded. And I rode him all through junior high and high school, and I mean, basically being here is, you know, part of that. that is having that horse hickory that I'll be riding here. So that's pretty special for me. But I kind of going along with what we're talking about, some of the best horses I've had besides this one were reject cutters even too. You know, like the Realm horse I rode all last year and one rookie of the year on. I rode the sorrel that I'm riding here a little bit, but that Realm was kind of what I rode. He was a reject cutter. Just lots of that. Oh man, they just read the cattle for you. You know, I mean, Elon, you got to be reading the corner and everything, and those horses just pretty much do it for you. That's what their instinct is. So that's nice.
Do you have any hard times going with the reject cutter? Because I know, like, with the cutters, they're taught to keep space with their cattle, but with them heading, you have to pull back, you have to wait. Is there any learning curve with those horses?
I've had a few. I've had a few that we've got that it kind of was tough because, you know, like you say, they're kind of taught to come off. So it takes a while. Like, I'll track the burrow, you know, or the lead steer, and kind of just give them confidence that they can get up there. But then quite a few that I've had, I mean, obviously, it's kind of their rejects kind of because they wanted to bleed in the cattle a little bit. You know? And so then they kind of naturally wanted to do that, you know, because that's kind of what they like. And so then it wasn't as hard. So maybe a little bit, but they want to get cattle.
They kind of jump if they want.
Yeah, they can do it.
Yeah, and then with that burrow, you know, tracking them, they do want to bleed too close. That burrow will keep them on as well.
Yeah,
just kind of,
definitely.
Just let them know you can't get this close.
Definitely.
There's so many good training tools out there between Helomatic and Hot Heels and all that stuff. I don't think you can find anything better than
I've used it a lot. I've been using Rope Smart a little bit, their dummy to switch, but before that, I used pretty much just a donkey, and you know, I still keep a donkey on you, I think that's really good.
You know, when I first started roping, we lived in New Mexico, and my dad bought a little bay horse from Martin Lucero. But Martin is he's the pride of New Mexico. He was one of the first guys to get out of there. Neil and I go over there, and I said, Dad, where's on Cadillac? He said, right there. Where? Because they have this nice little place in the valley in Dean Weber. And I said, where? So there's two burros right there. When we got home, he made me a pivot, and we got after it. They were a good training tool, too. But everything has gone so far. You see these guys, like, I've seen Quinn grow up in this sport of teamwork. Very young, and you watch this kid. I go to Arizona, and you just, how is it to this young have this much talent? And so, you know, congratulations. I've seen you go from, you know, the classification system up from novice to amateur to semi-pro, and now you're at the top, you know. So congratulations for doing that. What else do you do to get ready? I mean, you're competing with some guys here that have got the titles. I mean, your battle scar, their battle scar, what's the difference here?
I think, I guess one of the things for me, when I'm home a lot, I'm pretty much training horses. You know, we have a ranch and cattle, so I do that. And I ride a lot of colts and train a lot too, you know, because we used to have the double dollar sale, but when I'm home, I still train a lot. And so I think the biggest thing for me was just kind of being able to, I mean, obviously you're roping on those colts and you're still catching, but kind of being able to find a difference between, okay, I kind of was riding colts, now I'm going to get on my good horse and I need to be aggressive, you know, and kind of get that edge we're talking about, you know, and really just focus on roping and, you know, just making it sharp.
You know, there are a lot of kids out there that aspire to get to this level. How big is that horsemanship and jumping on different horses, and how big is that to help them? What would you suggest would be to, other than obviously trying to practice and get your time and maybe go to some school and figure that, but what would you tell somebody that's, you know, kind of on that verge of, man, I'm a four and I want to take it to another level?
Maybe that horsemanship is kind of the part that's stopping them. I think the biggest thing, one thing that really helped me is just getting on a lot of horses, and I know certain people, you know, you don't have obviously that opportunity, but I think the biggest thing is just wanting to learn and just having a desire to learn, you know. And I mean, there's so many tapes and schools and, you know, even taking different things from the cutting world or the reining world, you know, as far as horsemanship. That's something I'm grateful for my dad, you know. He kind of helped me see that, you know. It's not just roping, because I mean, sadly enough, sometimes team ropers, we can be the worst horsemen, you know.
Right.
You know, where, you know, cutting and reining and showing and stuff, but, you know, you focus more on training and your horse. And so I think if we can kind of learn from that and try to kind of converge that to riding our horse while we rope, it dang sure helps. It's helped me, and I think basically just focus on, you know, you don't know it all. And you need to learn, you need to be open-minded.
Right.
And if you're having a little problem, take advice, you know, work on what you do know.
Don't be afraid to ask questions,
yeah.
Really. Some people are. You think that you should know, and then you don't ask.
I think that's probably the greatest advice I have heard, though, is because the minute that you think you know everything is when you stop progressing.
Yeah.
And even being at the top end, being in Vegas at the Thomas & Mack, you still don't know everything, and you still have room to improve. And that's the ones that you see on top for so long are the ones that are always going after more and being better. So.
Absolutely.
Going back, I know that you talked a lot about how many horses that you've got on. Dad used to do the double dollar sale. You do club horse training. What do you look for in your team roping prospects?
We used to buy quite a bit, and my dad always kind of raced some horses, and now we've got to where we raise about all the ones we do, just, you know, because we have about 20 broodmares, and I'll buy some here and there. But mostly, the clientele that we sell to are mostly kind of mid to novice ropers that just want a good-minded, gentle. You know, obviously we have some reining, breeding, and cow horse. But if we can just get good looks, you know, good hip, nice little head, not too big, you know, 15-1 or 2. They're just real gentle. You know, we obviously ranch on them a lot. As long as they want to do it, that's pretty much what we, you know, look for as far as a prospect or a star.
Now, what about going down the road? Because sometimes that's a big push over is having the horsepower to get you down the road.
Definitely.
What are you looking for that sets that apart from the other person you have in the ranch?
That's probably a big thing, too, I had to work on. Growing up and being kind of novice and just going from, you know, catching and jackpot roping, you know, I mean, you can have a pretty good horse, but maybe he doesn't have enough run to go professional. And so I think the biggest thing for me was just, like, we'd have to buy some prospects for me, you know, that had more run, that were maybe a little more cowy or snappy. And I kind of had to learn to ride both, which was good for me, helping me with my horsemanship. But I think the biggest thing is just making sure they have enough, you know, especially the last 2 years having rodeoed. I mean, they got to be pretty tough. You know, they got to be tough, and they got to want to run and have heart. You know, they won't hold up. So I think that's the biggest thing. Is do they have enough, you know, enough go and grit to do it.
Now, you brought two horses to Vegas for the next 10 days. Tell us a little bit about those horses, why you brought them, and what you'll be riding.
So the Hickory horse that I kind of mentioned a little bit earlier, he's my main one that I'm going to start on because I've had him forever. I just know him. I trust him. Mm-hmm. You know, the biggest thing I really like with him is when those gates open, I mean, I can ride, and I pretty much just got to kick and ride as hard as I can, and he's not going to go by the corner. You know, he's gonna turn in and do it, so I have a lot of confidence that way. And then the other horse is named Wiz. He's kind of cut and bred, too. We got him when he was kind of younger as well and broke him. He kind of was, when he was younger, he was kind of an outlaw. He wanted to kind of buck, you know.
That's not perfect to me.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
but
exactly. So, you know, it took a lot of work, but now he still kind of has that grit and that try, so it's good, you know. And he stops, he slides, maybe a little harder, gets on his butt, but he's real free. You know, I can really get out around those steers on him, so I like him that way.
Now, you're going to be roping here with Matt Sherwood. You've roped with him for the last 2 years in the pro rodeo. Tell us a little bit about that pairing. He's a veteran.
Yeah.
This is your first year here.
For sure. It's been a great blessing to have Matt to go with, I think especially. You know, I knew a few guys when I started rodeoing last year, but not many, and I kind of knew Matt a little bit before that. You know, he's just been a great mentor as far as, you know, entering. He just knew that, and he knew how to get around, and he just knows how to win, you know.
That's big. Especially, how do you enter? What are we going to do? What's the map look like? I mean, that guy, he's done it.
Yeah, he's a veteran.
Yeah, so you have to have that guidance, because you'll see some of these guys that get in, they're your age, and they're very skilled, and they may be running open with somebody else the same age.
Yeah,
and it just doesn't work. You got to have one of them war dogs get in there and show you how to get it done. Because last year you finished 16th, just one out, right?
Yeah,
and it's like, all right, what do we got to do? What'd you do different this year, you think, that sets you apart?
I think, I don't know, I mean, it's tough because, I mean, it can be a leg or a barrier or a slip dally, you know, I mean, all year. And I think the two things that I think maybe I could have done better last year is, for one, I mean, we started a rodeo, and I guess you kind of realize you can make the finals, you know, but being my rookie year, I didn't fully maybe grasp that, you know, like, hey, I hope we do good, I'm going to try, you know, this is my dream, but I didn't fully say, hey, you know what, we're going to make that NFR, you know, I'm going to be there, and I wasn't as positive or focused on it.
Just believed it. Yeah.
Exactly, and then I think it just kind of made me realize how, I mean, that first run at Denver in January, I mean, that counts, you know, I mean, every dollar you make counts,
so,
you know, just don't let it slip through your hand, you know, try to take a little bit.
I know a lot of people come out big in the wintertime with all those big indoor rodeos, and then some you kind of just see creep in the background until summer hits. Do you like coming out ahead in the wintertime, or do you really like hitting it hard in the summer?
I love kind of what Matt, we did the last couple years, and I thought it worked pretty good, because I like to be home as much as I can, you know, to ride horses, and so mostly what we did, we went to like the 10 or 12 biggest rodeos over the winter. I mean, there's just some you don't want to miss, right? You know, Denver, you know, Fort Worth, some of those. So we went to those, you know, didn't get too crazy. And then summertime, you know, went to a few in the spring. And then summertime, I mean, there's just so many. And I mean, it's almost more cost effective if you can do good over the summer, just because you can go, I mean, you can almost go to a rodeo every day. So it makes it nice that way.
You're on your way home and you can hit a few.
Yeah, exactly. Where the winter's just kind of tough because it's just more spread out, right? You know, like you got to be in Texas for probably a couple months.
Well, and the weather too, especially when you're out in that area, you get snowstorms or anything like that. There's so much more to your traveling that you have to account for.
Definitely.
Where in the summer, if you're hitting it hard, you're driving all night going to the next rodeo, you can't do that with snowstorms.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, there's.
I can't do that. I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe there's better ones.
Definitely. There's ups and downs of both. I think one thing too, I mean, a little bit that goes into that is kind of your horsepower too. Definitely, I mean, run a few here and there is easier on your horse, you know, where they do have to be tough in the summer.
The horses that you brought to Vegas, are those the ones that you rodeated with all year, or do you rotate a couple other ones in just to kind of keep them fresh?
I had that roan that I rode a lot last year, and then I rode him a little bit at the first year, and then I sold him to Clint Robinson. He's been cap roping on him. And so, besides that, I pretty much rode this sorrel that I brought, the second sorrel, and my old horse Hickory that I'll be riding. I rode him a little bit, and then I have another kind of younger horse that I rode at maybe 7 or 8 rodeos, just when I needed him. But I think I'll probably ride that horse more this coming year. Yeah, but pretty much those two.
Now, like you and Matt, there's some distance between you guys as far as home, right?
Yep.
How do you guys make that work? What's the key to that? I mean, you guys obviously rope good, but you know, success is a rhythm. How do you get that rhythm?
Definitely. I think, in a way, it almost worked out a little better than you'd think, because he's in Arizona, you know, but he's not too far from Texas, and so sometimes I think my horses were at his house or in Texas all 3 months, or kind of in the winter.
Right.
And so sometimes I just fly down there, we practice a little bit, and then, you know, drive to Texas. So that worked pretty good. You know, and then in the summer, I mean, I'm in Utah, so decent for the summer. We get to practice a little bit. And then I think a great thing too is Matt just knows quite a few people, so we were able to practice a little along the way. Denture helps, you know.
Oh, that is. You got it. And that's what's neat about this rodeo too. It's a big network of people, and it takes a lot. And there's some unsung heroes back there that you know about. We will never see, but they know exactly what you're talking about. You were at their place, and you needed a place to stay, or you know, something went wrong with the horses, and you needed a good vet, and there's somebody out there. So you know, it's amazing how many people it actually takes to get this far.
Definitely.
Well, it's that whole concept. It's raising a village. Or
right.
Raising a child, taking a village, you know. Because you're going from California in the spring, you're up in Texas, Denver, that area in the wintertime, you're all over the place in the summer. I mean.
Yeah, it's a great blessing to have, you know, people, family, friends that support you and help you. You know, a lot of the guys going down the road rodeo and would be there for those great people.
Sure, yeah, sure.
Speaking of that support system, you recently were married, your wife, Jessie. Tell us about how important that support system is going down the road.
It's been great. Jessie, she's awesome because she kind of has the same background. She high school rodeoed, you know, and her family is into horses and stuff, and she still has some sisters in high school rodeo. So even just having that in common was great to begin with, and it's just nice because she gets it, you know, she gets rodeo life, and, you know, when we drive all night long, she doesn't love to drive, but when we need her, you know, she'll step in, and it's been nice to haul with her, because if you know, I'm not with Matt or somebody kind of buddying up, I have her to support me and ride with me, and she keeps my horses looking pretty and can help exercise them. It's just great. It's a big, huge help.
That's good. That's a blessing in itself right there.
Now, do you know what you've drawn for tonight?
We do not. I think you can find out maybe an hour and a half or so before or something like that. That's when we had to do the time events.
What's your game plan going in for your first round?
I don't know. The biggest thing that helps me is I normally don't get nervous. But I'll be probably a little nervous just because it's the first one. I think if I can get by this first one, then it'll be good. But my game plan is basically to just be real aggressive. And mostly what I focus on is just taking the first best shot I have, you know. And one thing, I don't try to overthink it either, you know. When those gates open, I'm going to just try to leave it to, you know, reaction. Because that's what we've trained and worked for. And so you just let it take over.
Kind of put it on autopilot and see what happens. You see it still going left and backside, and then know your shot.
Definitely. Yeah, so hope it works out good.
Well, we're all rooting for you, and we're excited to see you the first round of 2016 WNFR, and we will have Matt out here for autograph signings for the next half hour or so. Thank you so much for having coffee with us this morning.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Quinn. Yes.